Thank you. In this round of voting, in the selection of the Parliament's nominee as First Minister, the number of votes cast for each candidate is as follows. Alex Cole-Hamilton, 4. Douglas Ross, 31. Anna Sarwar, 22. John Swinney, 64. There were 7 abstentions. As there is an overall majority for John Swinney, on behalf of the Parliament, I congratulate Mr. Swinney as the Parliament's nominee for the position of First Minister and look forward to working with him. And I will call each of the party leaders to respond. I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I want to begin by congratulating John Swinney on his election as First Minister. The opportunity to lead the Scottish Government is the chance to serve every single person across our country, to give them the education they deserve, to ensure they can access the healthcare they need, to keep them safe from crime, and to help them to find the work that they need to provide for themselves and their family. That is a responsibility that should not be taken lightly. And I know that the First Minister, given his long career in Cabinet, will be acutely aware of the demands and that the decision to take up the role will not have been an easy one for him. And so I wish him well in taking on that burden. I also want to say how rightly proud his family must be today. We all know the strain that elective office has on our families, but that is magnified tenfold when the politician holds the office of First Minister. So on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, we offer our strength and support to the entire Swinney family as they provide the personal backing that will be so important to our new First Minister. Turning now to the government he leads, it cannot just serve one side of the constitutional argument. It must deliver for the whole of Scotland. Because a government acting in the national interests is what the Scottish people deserve. Yet the SNP have failed to deliver that in their time in office. The legislative achievements of this session are few and far between. Instead, we saw the SNP government, having run out of its own ideas, increasingly look for policy direction from the extreme Greens. At the same time, they were continuing the push for the same old tire campaign for independence and a referendum. John Swinney must swiftly change course and deliver a bold new policy agenda for this SNP government instead of treading water like his predecessors. And it should start by ruling out any agreement, by the back door or otherwise, with the Greens. If he wants to lead a government that represents the values of a clear majority of our country, then he cannot be reliant on the Greens for his agenda. The SNP must reach beyond creating a nationalist coalition to compromise and find consensus within this Parliament. Key to delivering that would be putting the campaign for independence on the back burner. The First Minister and his party must treat today as a reset moment. They must bring an end to a decade of division that has plagued our country since the 2014 referendum. With our education system at record lows in international rankings, 1 in 7 Scots on an NHS waiting list, violent crime rising, and our economy lagging behind the rest of the UK, Scotland faces significant challenges. Challenges that demand the SNP government's attention now. And in this, the 25th anniversary of our Scottish Parliament, it is clear that the institution is not living up to the promise that it offered to change the lives of people across Scotland for the better. The new First Minister must focus this chamber and his government back onto the issues that they were created to solve. Presiding Officer, while today may mark a new job for John Swinney, he has been at the heart of an SNP government for the last 17 years. He's been Alex Salmond's Finance Secretary, Nicola Sturgeon's Deputy and Hamza Yousaf's most prominent supporter. He sat round the Cabinet table and rubber-stamped every single one of the policies they enacted. But now, at long last, and perhaps with some reluctance, he has a shot at the top job. We know the kind of government minister John Swinney has been. We even know the kind of SNP leader he has been. But John Swinney, the First Minister, remains unknown. Presiding Officer, Scotland waits to see whether he will be a nationalist leader like his predecessor, or, as we on these benches hope, a national leader that Scotland needs to take our country forward. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, on behalf of the Scottish Labour Party, I offer John Swinney my sincerest congratulations on being nominated as Scotland's next First Minister. I know that this will be a moment of tremendous pride for him and his family, the culmination of a long career of public service, one of which I know he has made many personal sacrifices. So I wish him and his loved ones well and the very best in the weeks and months to come. I must say I'm particularly pleased to see Mr Swinney's wife Elizabeth and his family in the gallery today. We send them our best wishes and love. Presiding Officer, we choose to be in politics, but our families don't. But it's often them that have to pay the heaviest burden and have the most significant impact. So, as others have said, we wish them all the very, very best for the future. Our political disagreements are many, but we share a common purpose to make Scotland the best place to grow up and grow old in. And I note Mr Swinney's comments that he will look to work across this chamber in a way that has sadly escaped his predecessors. We will continue to work constructively where we can and promote the national interest. We believe in the principles of devolution and the consensus that we can try and build across our Parliament. But I think it's important to note that the SNP, who have been one of the architects of divisive politics, so I do not question the rhetoric and the pretense of them now somehow being the great unifiers of our nation. So I hope we will finally do away with the use of words like traitors or the fought outrage in the language of betrayal that has come from far too many ministers, let alone activists. And I hope that this work can start immediately so we can move on and try to show the very best of Scotland. But, Presiding Officer, as I said before, I fear this election is more about managing the SNP rather than delivering for Scotland. We need more than just a change of leader or indeed a change in language. We need an acceptance of what's gone wrong and we need a change of direction. At this time of national crisis, people need a government that is willing to lend a hand and support them, not feel abandoned by this government and indeed the UK government time and time again, politicians putting party before the country. Because the truth is that this internal stitch-up has delivered a continuity candidate who does bear responsibility for so much of the instability we have seen. So let's not pretend this is day one of a new SNP government. We shouldn't also forget that John Swinney, as Deputy First Minister during the COVID pandemic, was also responsible for deleting thousands of records and withholding evidence meant for the COVID inquiry. So yes, we need to see an end to the culture of secrecy and cover-up, but I fear the SNP have elected to the highest office one of its champions. We also need to see an end to the incompetence in managing our public services, but instead I think the SNP have elected perhaps the worst education secretary in the history of our Parliament, because in classrooms across the country, violence is on the rise, teachers feel unsupported, and pupils are being failed by a government who don't feel they have the same ambitions they do. And on the 25th anniversary of devolution, they have chosen as a man the finance secretary who decimated local government, sucked up power into Holyrood, and decimated local services as a result. So I hope we see a new approach from John Swinney, one that genuinely puts the national interest before party interest, and the promise we make is that we will work constructively to make sure we achieve the best for Scotland and its people. But to put it bluntly, continuity won't cut it. We can't afford more distracted, divided, incompetent government. We need to get on with fixing the mess of the last 17 years and get on to delivering for the people of Scotland. So I wish, of course, the First Minister well for the future, but he needs to recognise that the public are crying out for change. I think that change can only come with an election, and I can't wait to get on with the job of delivering for the people of Scotland.
Thank you, and I call Lorna Slater.
Congratulations to John Swinney on behalf of myself and the Scottish Green Group. We recognise the right of the SNP as the largest party in this chamber to form a government, and we are content, in the spirit of stable governance, that they have managed to do so. The Scottish Greens have worked constructively with John Swinney over many years, both as partners in government and from the opposition benches, and we look forward to building a similarly constructive relationship as he takes up the role of First Minister. However, our explicit support for an SNP First Minister has always been conditional on a shared vision and policy programme, one which tackles the climate crisis head-on, which builds a fairer, more equal future, and which continues to make the case for an independent Scotland. The new First Minister has yet to lay out the vision for his new government, hence our group's abstention in the vote today. I am proud of what the Scottish Greens achieved during our time in government, lifting 100,000 children out of poverty, delivering free bus travel for young people, banning new incinerators, the most polluting single-use plastics, and putting in place emergency rent controls during the cost of living crisis. These are things which are already making people's lives better, thanks to the Scottish Greens. But there was so much work still yet to be completed. We had just introduced a housing bill which creates new rights for tenants and a permanent system of rent controls. Our heat and buildings programme was transforming the way we heat our homes to drive down emissions and give everyone a warm home that they can afford to heat. This has been billed as a template for the rest of the UK by the Climate Change Committee. The process to appoint Scotland's new national park was well underway, driving investment into Scotland's rural communities. The proposed Natural Environment Bill would have created new protections and legislative tools to help restore nature in Scotland, bringing a watertight ban on conversion therapy to protect some of the most vulnerable people in our society. These remain our priorities as Scottish Greens, and we will continue to advocate for the fairer, greener, more equal Scotland that they create. In the coming days and weeks, the First Minister must lay out whether his government will continue with these progressive policies, as well as the recent commitment to ramp up action on the climate emergency, or whether he will retreat to the middle ground and rely on the Tories and other pro-union parties to complete the work of government. If our parties can continue to work towards a shared vision of a fairer, progressive, independent Scotland, which takes its responsibilities to future generations seriously, our door remains open. The Scottish Greens will keep working for a better future with courage and determination, and I hope the new Scottish Government will as well.
Thank you. I now call Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats, I'd like to offer John Swinney our sincere congratulations on his appointment as the nominee for First Minister. I also want to record our thanks, as others have done, to his family in particular, for the sacrifice that this nation is now asking of them. I know that consideration weighed heavily on his mind while weighing up the decision to stand. Before I talk in more detail about what's next and the challenges that befall our new First Minister, I'd like to thank Humza Yousaf for his service. I wish the outgoing First Minister, Nadia, and their family well, particularly as they await their new arrival to their family. Politics can be a bruising business. You win some, you lose some. For any elected position, you have to offer your ideas, your character, and your values up for scrutiny and public debate, and that can be tough. And in those moments, you need your loved ones around you, which is why I liked that on the night of his resignation, Humza Yousaf's reaction was to go straight home and read bedtime stories to his children. Those precious moments do help provide perspective at the end of a hard day. It reminded me of the Humza Yousaf I first met 12 years ago when I was a youth worker, and I sincerely wish him well. I'm also in the market for tips with dealing with Tavish Scott. Presiding Officer, John Swinney didn't know it when he relinquished the reins of the SNP leadership 20 years ago, but his party was on the threshold of power. Today, as he picks up those reins back up again, he may not know it or choose to believe it, but I believe that the SNP now stand on the threshold of defeat. He has come full circle, but I genuinely hope, in the time that he has, that he can make a positive impact on the public services on which we all rely, that he can bring growth back to our economy, and that his government can get the basics right. I say that because I love my country and I want the very best for it, but for every day, from 2004 to 2024, he has been party to and complicit in every significant decision taken by SNP High Command or round the cabinet table of the Scottish Government. Presiding Officer, the SNP's record in government is John Swinney's record in government. And I'm not sure fair-minded people will be convinced that after 17 years of that government, it has the fresh ideas and the vision needed to move Scotland forward. Indeed, it appears to be business as usual when it comes to independence. And the circumstances under which the SNP once again wish to press this divisive agenda could not be less forgiving. I want to welcome, though, his commitment to striking a more consensual tone in a parliament that has been too divided in recent years. Now, I am confident there will be areas we can find common ground, but my party will continue to hold this government to account too, where it falls short. I would like to see, first and foremost, the new First Minister overhaul its approach to government transparency and record-keeping, because the pandemic further exposed the culture of secrecy that has existed throughout the Scottish Government. The work of the UK and Scottish COVID inquiries have been made all the harder by the deletion of evidence that Anas Sarwar referenced. But he has the power now to change that culture. So too does he have the power to drop the ministerial takeover of social care, putting that money towards services and staff, unlocking the crisis in our health service, give councils the power surge they need to deliver locally, improve outdated standards that see sewage dumped in our rivers. A finance secretary for many years, I'm sure tax and spend will also be at the forefront of his mind, as we've just learned that the Scottish Government's medium-term financial strategy will be delayed. There will also be delays to the draft tax strategy and infrastructure plan. We need those long-term visions now, because taxpayers and businesses have no idea what will happen next. That's not a conducive environment for growth, and it will not give people the confidence to invest here. Presiding Officer, I conclude by saying this. He may have arrived here with some reluctance, but John Swinney is Scotland's new First Minister. I accept that and I congratulate him. He is known as a deal maker, but the enmity that now exists across this chamber will make the paralysis that gripped Scottish politics last week all the more likely. When that happens in a democracy, the best way forward is to go back to the people who sent us to this place and ask them for new instructions in the form of a Scottish parliamentary election. I appreciate that he has ruled that out, but our votes will remain available towards the dissolution of this place and that end. We will always look for consensus where we can find it on the priorities of the party and those who sent us here. For a renewed focus on net zero, for ready access to GP services at the first time of asking, and for NHS dentistry. On all those issues which have been crying out for ministerial attention, we will lay aside our differences where we can. So let me conclude by offering him the hearty congratulations of my party. Thank you.
Thank you, and I now call John Swinney.
Presiding Officer, I am very grateful to Douglas Ross, Anas Sarwar, Lorna Slater and Alex Cole-Hamilton for their kind comments this afternoon, and especially their comments in relation to the support of my family. Presiding Officer, when I stood down as Deputy First Minister in March last year, I believed that would be the last senior office I would hold in politics. Having served then as a senior minister for 16 years, I felt I had, to coin a phrase, done my bit. To find myself accepting office as First Minister of Scotland today is therefore, to utter a classic understatement, something of a surprise. It is, however, an extraordinary privilege, and it is my honour to accept the office of First Minister, committing myself to do the best I can for Scotland. As I navigated my way through the media pack in the corridors of this Parliament last week, prior to announcing my candidacy for the SNP leadership, I tried to explain that I was taking my time to decide whether to stand, because I had to be certain it was a decision that was right for my family. For me, my answers to the media were not a stalling tactic or an evasive answer from an experienced politician. For me, it was the truth. Members will know that my wife, Elizabeth, has multiple sclerosis. She is indefatigable in trying to make sure that MS does not get in the way of her living life to the full. But much to her frustration, she does often have to rely on her husband for support and assistance. I could not just commit myself to become First Minister without being able to properly work out with my family how we would be able to manage as a family. We've talked that through, and we will manage. But I cannot let this moment pass without making clear to Elizabeth my profound eternal gratitude for the sacrifices she is prepared to make to enable her husband to serve our country as First Minister. I am so pleased that my father, my wife and children, members of my family and our dearest friends are able to be here today to see this moment. My only regret is that my beloved mother did not live long enough to see this day. As her parish minister wrote to me yesterday, your mum would have been quietly proud. My mother's love of literature and poetry, which rubbed off on her two sons, would have prompted her to find some words that would sum up this moment. Yesterday I was asked what would be the single most important policy objective for my government. I made it clear it would be the eradication of child poverty. So in searching for words to sum up this occasion, perhaps my mother would have chosen these words from one of Scotland's greatest poets, Hamish Henderson, who was born in Blairgowrie, in the very beating heart of my Perthshire constituency. In his epic anthem, Freedom Come All Ye, which I heard Hamish Henderson sing from an open-top bus in the meadows of our great capital city during a rally that demanded the establishment of this very parliament in the early 1990s, Hamish Henderson wrote, "So come all ye at hame with freedom, never heed what the hoodies croak for doom, in your hoose or the bairns of Adam can find breed, barley brie and painted room." If there was ever an anthem that railed against child poverty, those words from Hamish Henderson echo through the straths and streets of our diverse country as a call for us to act. So I will be unapologetic about bringing to this Parliament the measures we can take to eradicate child poverty, and I look forward to seeking the support of others to achieve that aim. Because I recognise that's how it's going to have to work. I am leading a minority government. I will need to reach out to others to make things happen, to pass legislation, to agree a budget. These sound like dry, technical parliamentary terms. But what they mean in reality is if we want to fund our schools and hospitals, if we want to give our businesses a competitive edge, if we want to take climate action, if we want to eradicate child poverty, if we want to change people's lives for the better, we have got to work together to do so. This Parliament, as colleagues have fairly recognised, is intensely polarised at this time. I accept my part in creating that environment. Whether that is by shouted put-downs from the front bench or heckling from a sedentary position. I do promise, Presiding Officer, that that will all stop. I have changed. Perhaps time will tell on that one. This is not the collaborative place it has been in the past. A collaborative place that has done so much good to improve the lives of people in Scotland. As the Parliament marks its 25-year anniversary, and as one of the relatively small group who have been here from the start, I reflect on the major developments that have taken place by collaborative work and agreement over that time. Major developments taken forward by the Labour and Liberal executive, such as the ban on smoking in public places, or minimum unit pricing by the SNP government, or the introduction of free bus travel for under-22s by the SNP Green Partnership. I commit my government to working to create that agreement across the chamber. I hope there is space and the willingness for that to happen in the interests of the people who sent us here. Now, it is hardly a surprise to anyone in this chamber that I believe that this country could do more if we had the powers of a normal, independent nation. Others in this chamber take the opposite view. That is the essence of democracy. People free to hold and express and pursue different opinions. The question we face in this Parliament today, however, is a more practical one. Does our disagreement on the Constitution prevent us from working collaboratively within the existing powers of the Parliament to eradicate child poverty, build the economy, support jobs, address the cost of living crisis, improve the health service, and tackle the climate crisis? I will give all of my energy and my willingness to engage and listen to ensure that that is not the case. I invite others to do the same. Presiding Officer, when I pitched up at Forrester High School in this city in 1979, at the age of 15, wearing my SNP badge, and my friends and teachers wondered why I had become involved in this fringe party, I could scarcely have imagined that my journey would involve becoming the First Minister of Scotland. It is an extraordinary privilege to hold this office, and I thank Parliament warmly for the honour that has been given to me. To the people of Scotland, I would say simply this. I offer myself to be the First Minister for everyone in Scotland. I am here to serve you. I will give everything I have to build the best future for our country.
Thank you. Thank you. That concludes the selection of First Minister, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business. And I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister for Parliamentary Business to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and happily to do so. Moved.
Thank you. And the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and having fulfilled that requirement under Standing Orders, I can confirm that there are no questions to be put as a result of today's business. So that concludes decision time, and we'll now move on to members' business in the name of Richard Leonard. Thank you.